White Rabbit presents Faster Than a Cannonball, 1995 and All That, by Dylan Jones. Read by Russell Bennett, Jessica Preddy, Leighton Pugh and Kris Dyer.
Preface. The Self-Preservation Society. Michael Caine and I did the Italian job in 69. He was teaching me Cockney rhyming slang and said, "Quincy, you don't speak the fucking rhyme, the Gregory Peck bit. You say the first word, just the one word. Nobody knows what the fuck you're talking about. It's like bebop talk, which is where hip-hop talk came from." Quincy Jones. It is one of the most famous film endings in the history of British cinema. The final scene of The Italian Job, as a pile of recently stolen gold bullion starts slipping towards the rear of a customized coach, as it seesaws over an alpine precipice, Michael Caine's lovable rogue, Charlie Croker, turns towards the rest of his gang, who are nervously huddled near the front of the bus, and says, in his trademark timbre, "Hang on a minute, lads, I've got a great idea." As the camera pans away, climbing high over the Cerasoli Reale Reservoir, some 40 miles northwest of Turin, Quincy Jones's jaunty Cockney knees up rumbles as the credits roll, its sing-along rhyming slang contrasting sharply with the overly sumptuous mountain scenery. Designed by the filmmakers as an affirmation of British self-confidence in an age of fading empire, the film is a lovingly crafted display of national pride disguised as a heist caper. The ending, which was disliked by both Caine and the director, Peter Collinson, and so assigned to the second unit, is not just a literal cliffhanger, while obviously allowing for a sequel, which didn't happen because the film wasn't successful in America. It also espoused an ardent Britishness, an alternative Albion, loud and proud. As the cast turned the Self-Preservation Society into a terrorist chant, the song was actually called "Get a Blooming Move On," although no one has ever called it that. You almost expect Union Jack bunting to come flying across the screen, a celebration of all things green and pleasant. It was a very particular kind of Britain that the filmmakers were portraying, and initially it didn't travel well. In the 1969 review in The Hollywood Reporter, the critic John Mahoney said the film belabours the Rule Britannia manner, while Quincy Jones's score was erratic, very good when it is good, and just as noisy when it isn't. Which, let's face it, was very 1995, as well as very 1969. In February that year, EMI released Showtime, a video of Blair's gig at Alexandra Palace in North London on October the 7th, 1994, supported by Pulp, Supergrass, and a band called Corduroy. Ali Pally was described by the NME's Sylvia Patterson as a cartoon castle in the air, high above London in Ray Davis's manor, playing host to Blur's invincible pop songs encased in carousel hornpipe novelty icing. This gig was a major pit stop on the Britpop roadmap, a concert that would live long in the memories of those who were there, and perhaps even longer in the memories of those who watched it all on video afterwards, furious with themselves for missing it in person, but mightily relieved there was a record of it all the same. It was a Saturday night, and 10,000 people had made their way there from all over Europe. By the end of 1994, Britpop had become such a phenomenon that it was fast becoming something of a tourist attraction, with people travelling from far and wide to catch a fleeting glimpse of a member of Elastica sinking bottles in the Good Mixer in Camden, or loitering outside the Groucho Club in Soho's Dean Street, hoping for a sighting of Blur's Alex James, the comedian Keith Allen, or their new friend, the artist Damien Hirst. There was such a lot of noise swirling around the Britpop world that you could get lost in the lurid blur of tabloid lunacy as the papers squeezed every last drop out of any sweat-drenched Fred Perry top they could find. By the time 1995 kicked into gear, London was a city enthralled to its past, filling an imaginary Pathé newsreel with images of youthful icons of art, music, fashion, food, and film. According to the voiceover, even its politicians were cool. Contemporary London felt like a theme park, masquerading as a fairground, with carousels of provocations popping up everywhere from Soho to Shoreditch, from Notting Hill to Spitalfields. All over the city, fast-talking Sharpies with dodgy connections were talking to anyone who would listen about the Billy Bonkers pop-up gallery, quasi-revolutionary nightclub, super-slick restaurant they were just about to open, when they had secured the financing, that is. As Vanity Fair said when they flitted over to collate their special edition on Swinging London, every rotting wharf, every disused factory, every seedy locale where Ronnie Cray once nailed someone's head to the floor is a restaurant or arts complex waiting to happen. Elvis Costello, himself the beneficiary of the excitement surrounding a previous iteration of Swinging London back in the punk days of 1977, was somewhat less enthusiastic about this turn of events. But then perhaps it was only fitting that the previous generation should want to have nothing to do with the next. "If a city makes you arrogant and cruel, then something's happening in it," he said. "I'm just old enough to remember the swinging 60s, when London was like that last. It's getting to be a bit like that now." This was the heightened time when Swinging London really did seem important again, a period when Brit very quickly became the only acceptable prefix for cultural insurrection. Not that the lucky 10,000 inside Ali Pali cared. Even before it began, the stratospheric levels of anticipation had already preordained this as a night to remember. A pivotal show that slotted in between the Criminal Justice Bill and the World Cup would be voted by Melody Maker as the fifth most important event of the year. Tonight, ancient elegance, well-ish, Ali Pali was built in 1873, and new opulence were all tangled up in a dazzling blur of op and pop. As the theme of the evening appeared to be centred around a kind of super-arch nostalgie de la boue, so it was perhaps only natural that there was a game of bingo before Blur appeared on stage.
"Hello, hello, hello, it's bingo time, aye?"
said Malcolm Hill, the compere come bingo caller, perfectly cast as he wasn't funny.
"The prize tonight is a night out with Blur."
After a few minutes calling out winning numbers, he ends the charade by asking the crowd, somewhat rhetorically, what position Park Life had entered the charts at, before answering his own question.
"Number one!"
Having got this far without a hitch, he then quickly cuts to the chase by declaring them all to be winners. All 10,000 of them.
"You've all won a night out with Blur," he repeats, "and here they are."
As the curtains rise, the band rush on as Get a Blooming Move On suddenly blares its way around the venue. Michael Caine and Co. imploring the Blur Massive to wash their German bands and boat races, comb their barnets, put on their dicky dirts and peck 'em rise. Soon everyone is singing Get Your Skates On, Mate, and all is right with the world. What fun. It's just like 1969. Just like the Italian Job. Maybe there will be a fleet of Mini Coopers waiting outside to take everyone home from the show. Maybe Noel Coward will be carried on stage in a throne. Maybe Michael Caine himself will turn up, lean into the mic, give us all a stage wink and say,
"You were only supposed to blow the bloody doors off."
Maybe. All of a sudden, the band lurch into Lot 105. A throwaway song from Park Life, which sounds like the theme tune to a cheesy 70s TV game show. Lot 105, referring to the Hammond organ Damon plays in the song, acquired at an auction for £150. Boom. There is no getting around it. This is fairground music. Hilarified by Wurlitzer sounds and a sense of the bizarre, Damon Albarn's words spinning through the air like coloured balls, Alex James's bass and Graham Coxon's scratchy guitar supplying the requisite amounts of jutting chin-punk. It's all very bouncy. It's all very vaudevillian. And it's all very 1995. At their height, inside a hurricane of their own creation, neither Noel nor Liam Gallagher would ever miss an opportunity to remind you that what was happening would never be repeated. They were at the peak of their powers, ensconced in a cultural bubble, and they couldn't believe what they could see. In essence, the Oasis brothers could have been talking about the mid-90s full stop, because while they were themselves embodying the paradox of living a dream on behalf of the masses, elsewhere in the culture, a sense of national exuberance was almost at its zenith. And 1995 was its peak. Decades tend to crest at the midway point, and 1995 was the year of the 90s. It was peak Britpop, Oasis versus Blur, peak YBA, Tracey Emin's Tent, peak New Lad, when Nick Hornby published High Fidelity, when James Brown's Loaded detonated the publishing industry, and when pubs were finally allowed to stay open on a Sunday. It was the year of the Bends, the year Danny Boyle started filming Trainspotting, the year Richey Edwards tragically went missing, the year Alex Garland wrote The Beach, the year Blair changed Clause 4 after a controversial vote at the Labour conference. And it was the high watermark of swinging London too. Not only was the mid-90s perhaps the last time rock stars, music journalists, and pop consumers held onto a belief in rock's mystical power, it was a period of huge cultural upheaval in art, literature, publishing, and inevitably, drugs. It was also a period of almost unparalleled hedonism, a time when many people thought they deserved to live the rock and roll lifestyle, when a generation of narcotic omnivores thought they could all be rock stars just by buying a magazine and a copy of What's the Story Morning Glory. It's taken a while, but it's now possible to see the 90s as the most creative post-war decade of them all, a decade that, far from ending when it did, continues to regenerate. Its influence continues to echo down the ages, an echo of defiance, of whatever, of not caring what others really think of us at all. The catalysts for change arrived thick and fast. The death of Labour leader John Smith accelerated the arrival of Tony Blair. The Broadcasting Act sparked a sea change in the world of television. Cue cocky independent TV companies and their noisy shows. The Word, TFI Friday, Italian 90 ushered in a renewed love of football. The Mary Whitehouse experience showed comedians could become rock stars. Soap operas actually started holding a mirror up to their audience with lesbian kisses and black families in Albert Square. The national lottery started, and a generation of Brits saw they could become millionaires without having to work for it. The mid-90s was also an extraordinarily successful period for British black music, much of which was influenced by the demands of US hip-hop, with everyone from Massive Attack and Tricky, Gabrielle and Goldie having international success alongside Britain's thriving dance music scene. Meanwhile, there was a packed conveyor belt of news stories. First, there was the fall of the Berlin Wall, which was swiftly followed by the Gulf War, a confrontation we watched on television, and one which turned Norman Schwarzkopf into the first US military celebrity in a generation. "Talk to me, General Schwarzkopf, tell me about it," sang Madonna during her performance at the 1991 Academy Awards. Then there was the death of Freddie Mercury, as AIDS ripped through the artistic community. Nelson Mandela became president of South Africa, and President Bill Clinton wrestled with Monica Lewinsky and later his reputation. Even though global governance became the new shibboleth of international relations, throughout it all, Britain was once again establishing itself as a crucial cultural force. The 90s chimed with the 60s in being a decade that was almost uniquely British. It was also the last analogue decade, If the story of pop music is largely the story of the intertwining post-war pop culture of the United States and the United Kingdom, that ended in the 90s. While grunge and alt-rock were surging on the airwaves and the campuses of North America, with the likes of Pearl Jam and Nirvana carving out solid careers by dressing down in ripped jeans and sweaters and coming off as the completely ordinary, down-to-earth gents of raw, organic rock, many Americans remember the 90s as a relatively tranquil era wedged between the Reagan era and the Age of Terror. After a fleeting glance from the Brits, it was the Union Jack-waving custodians of Britpop who captured the zeitgeist. Some, such as the Pet Shop Boys' Neil Tennant, felt this signaled a kind of ironic jingoism. And yet it was this fervent environment that gave birth to the likes of the Spice Girls, the biggest British cultural export since the Beatles, which fared into New Labour's famous 1997 election victory, celebrated by everyone from Vanity Fair to Mike Myers' Austin Powers. Perhaps irrationally, we find it natural to imagine that life assumes a completely new character every 10 years. However, the 90s were fundamentally different to the decade that preceded them. Far from being just a great year for pop, 1995 had a deeper place in the collective cultural psyche. The cool Britannia period is usually contextualized by its demise, by the bombast of Oasis's cocaine-fueled third album, Be Here Now, by the death of Princess Diana, and of course the eventual disappointment of New Labour, having triggered culture wars over everything from fox hunting to homosexuality in a rush towards change and modernization. Tony Blair appeared to ruin it all by deciding to support George W. Bush in the second Iraq War. There's also the suggestion that all this nationalistic flag-waving was somehow a precursor to Brexit. But this negates the country's metamorphic primacy as a cultural center during one of the most creative periods of the late 20th century. And while it lasted, and it lasted for approximately 4 years, just about the same time as swinging London did back in the 60s, it was a truly wonderful thing. Here was Oasis, going from fourth on the bill at King Tut's Wah Wah Hut in Glasgow to playing to 250,000 people at Knebworth. Here was Definitely Maybe becoming the fastest-selling debut album of all time. Here was Blur and Pulp. Here was Damien Hirst cutting sheep in half, Oliver Payton opening his postmodern gin palace, the Atlantic Bar and Grill, Oswald Botang invading Savile Row with Purple Line bespoke suits, Kate Moss, the Comran Shop, a veritable publishing phenomenon, and even the unceremonious return of the Beatles. Histories are categorized according to what the writer has chosen as the basic unit of explanation, and in this case, that unit is music, art, films, politics, self-expression, cool and funny magazines, selling in their millions, and an optimism that percolated amid great social upheaval. Beneath mythology and allegory is usually the shabby and sordid truth. But with Cool Britannia, the opposite was true. A year of champagne supernovas, pop art iconography, political expediency, and untucked check shirts, 1995 would define the decade it bisected. Every time pop culture comes full circle, it seems to pick up speed. In 1995, it was faster than a cannonball.
Foreword. 1990 to 1994, the Roaring Nineties. There was more to Cool Britannia than a Soho coterie high on booze, cocaine and mutual backslapping. In its early incarnation, before the branding and the marketing took over entirely, there was a moment when popular culture enjoyed one of its periodic peaks of creativity. Alwyn W. Turner, A Classless Society, Britain in the 1990s.
Alistair Campbell, journalist. The 90s was an important cultural period for the country because there was a sense of decline followed by resurgence and renaissance. And sometimes these political moments and moods do capture something different. The 90s was one of those moments. For example, would we have gone for the London Olympics if we hadn't had that sense of cultural reinvigoration? I don't think so. It bred a kind of confidence that had a lot of positive effects.
Nick Hornby, writer. It had been a long time since I'd felt as though something was happening in my country, and all of these things led to the impression there was some kind of post-Thatcher reclaiming of culture as something that mattered. There was a lot going on in the 80s, but a lot of it felt like resistance rather than celebration.
Alan McGee, Creation Records. At the start of the 90s, it was all beginning. I'd just come out of a terrible 89 and was nearly bankrupt. I was about to release Primal Screams Loaded. I just signed Ride, and it just started popping. What was quite interesting was all these things are utterly circumstantial. You've always got to seize the moment, and luckily, I was smart enough to seize the moment. Creation was about the eighth biggest indie label in Britain behind One Little Indian, Rough Trade, Factory, 4AD, and Big Life. So we were floundering, but I could feel things were changing.
Fiona Miller, journalist. Cool Britannia was a real thing, a feeling of liberation. I remember there was Kris Smith, who was the first openly gay cabinet minister. The politics reflected what was going on in society and tried to lead it a bit, and that was hugely significant for an awful lot of people.
Jefferson Hack, journalist. Taking drugs and meeting people, that's what it was about. A great period of innocence and optimism.
Noel Gallagher, musician. I loved the 90s and a lot of it passed through my kitchen. I liked Damien, and Kate Moss was a great friend. It was a great period, a great moment in time. No one will ever admit it, and every time I say this, it gets picked up by the wrong fucking members of the press and turned on its head. But we were all Thatcher's children, who got off our arses and did it for ourselves. What I mean is that this all happened in spite of Thatcherism. We were all on the dole, all on benefits, and it must have dawned on us all that we were not going to get anything and that nothing would be given to us. So we had better go and fucking find a way of taking it. To me, the 90s was a lot of working-class intellectuals who were not really connected, who all came through at the same time in politics, music, fashion, photography, art, sport. You know, that young Muslim kid, Prince Nassim, was the greatest boxer that ever fucking lived at that point. And it was like, who the fuck is this guy? It just seemed to be a working class thing. That's what I took from it. Everyone I met was sound, more or less. And all the other players in the game, like Jarvis, Hursty, everyone was fucking great. There were also a lot of Northerners, which is another unusual thing. I do remember having one of those 5 a.m. cocaine conversations where I was saying, this fucking decade will be remembered as one of the greatest, and everyone else being like, nah. I felt at the time this collection of people would eventually become the mainstream. The 90s now is revered as probably the last great decade where we were free, because the internet had not enslaved us all and driven the world's neurosis to the point of fucking paralysis, where you can't say or be or do or suggest or take the piss out of or be irreverent about anything or any fucking section of society. Whereas back then, everything was fucking spontaneous and off the cuff, particularly in my life. I didn't think about anything. When I saw the Alan McGee film, Creation Stories, and I was thinking that will never happen again because today there are too many spreadsheets. Back in those days, it was put it out, see what happens, and move on to the next thing. You know, magazines and fucking radio shows and physical things that people could hold. Whereas now, it's all podcasts and fucking Netflix.
Gregor Muir, writer and curator. I spent Christmas 1990 in New York, staying at the Paramount Hotel, in a room next to Mickey Rourke.
On New Year's Eve, I went to see Delight and Grace Jones at the Palladium, and the city felt young and alive. And I came back to London, which felt like a morgue. The most exciting thing was the 24-hour supermarket in Ladbroke Grove. I had a very vivid sense of a decaying city, that London was up for grabs. There was a sense of an underground culture coming up. My generation were the first to capitalise on those desires, realising the art world could become a conduit to a living and to some form of excitement in a way that hadn't been necessarily so available before. A lot of it stems from the post-punk period of people who had taken their art away from Cork Street because they'd seen more exciting ways to express themselves through clothes, record cover designs, music, through virtually everything except still life painting. I'd just left Camberwell's School of Art and was on the dole. That seemed to be the club of choice at that time. I really struggled for a while trying to consider myself an artist, but then I bought an Amstrad and started to write. One of the important strands of the period is the way in which postmodernism changed what people were doing. The postmodern movements in New York were completely translatable, so in London you started to see a repurposing and a kind of ad hocism. But there was a different ethos that kicked in, because our decrepitude and the things that were eroding around us were old empire. Just look at Judy Blame, repurposing rubbish as jewellery, which is the most transformative of all activities in that sense, turning things into gold. It's cultural salvage. So by the time you get Sarah Lucas's Two Fried Eggs and Kebab in 1992, it's a form of alchemy. The early 90s were all about things getting rebuilt and remade out of the ruins. Just look at Damien's medicine cabinets, which were initially salvaged from the old hospitals Thatcher had closed around South London.
Sarah Lucas, artist. In the early days, we'd all go out as a gang and get drunk at private views because the booze was free. The art world is very social, and the only way you find out what's going on is by going out. When you become successful, you have a choice, but when you're starting out, you want to plug in. Sadie Coles, gallerist. The most important thing about the period was a sense of community. There was this feeling of all in it together. Even people who hadn't been to Goldsmiths, like Tracey Emin, Rachel Whiteread, or Peter Doig. The hedonism cemented that feeling. Louisa Buck, critic. Not since pop art in the 60s had art been so important in Britain. You had the YBAs, Jay Jopling, Nick Sirota, Charles Saatchi, the Glasgow School, all these key people who suddenly took contemporary art into the cultural mainstream. Tate Modern wouldn't have happened without that energy. Before the 90s, we really didn't take art seriously. In the 80s, you'd go to someone's house and they'd have amazing designer furniture, the latest clothes and an incredible stereo, but they'd still have a framed poster on the wall, which would have been unthinkable in the 90s. Doris Lockhart, collector. This period was so important because it put Britain on the international contemporary art scene. Britain had been treated rather patronizingly, and New York was king of the world at the time for contemporary art. No one was interested in what was going on here. Suddenly, these kids started getting shows in New York, and everybody wanted the art by these young Brits. I mean, look at what happened to Damien. Everybody wanted a Damien Hirst painting.
Jay Jopling, gallerist. I was very lucky to be in the right place at the right time. I really enjoyed the artist's company. We had a lot of fun. The art was provocative, a kickback against Thatcher. That generation came out of art school, kicking and screaming, and I happened to be in London at the time. With Damien, there was very strong personal chemistry, shared ambition, an overriding desire to get things done yesterday. When we met, We left each other at 4 a.m, and at 9 a.m, there he was at my house in Brixton. He showed me his plans for sculptures, fish cabinets, the shark, the first spot paintings, and we said, let's make them. Michael Bracewell, journalist and author. As Britpop split into the Brit culture of Brit art and the heavily over-mediated neo-swinging London, as championed by British glossy magazines from GQ to The Telegraph magazine, so a new aristocracy of wholly metropolitan socialites, art dealers, PR gurus and restaurateurs would benefit from the mini-boom. For Noel and Liam Gallagher, from the depressed suburb of Burnage, South Manchester, there must have been a delicious sense of victory in realising the old escape route from working-class drudgery through football or pop was still open, and it could still make the toffs dance to their tune. Hence, Noel Gallagher on the television programme TFI Friday, displaying his neatly shoed foot to a fawning Kris Evans and barking one word, Gucci.
Sophie Hastings, journalist. In the 90s, restaurants and the art world started to be inextricably linked. It began with Jeremy King, who put contemporary art in his restaurants, in the Ivy and Scott's, in a way that hadn't happened before. Because Mark Hicks was his executive chef and because Mark knew all the YBAs, he started to collect and oversaw the collection at Scott's. St. John's, Fergus Henderson's restaurant, became the artist's HQ in Clerkenwell. There was a real restaurant culture, where gallery openings and private views and after-parties started to be really important. There was lots of rule-breaking, what the Chapman brothers called wasting time intelligently, where they sat around at the Golden Heart. This place, which had once been full of prostitutes and market traders, became the YBA pub. The landlady was Sandra Esquilant, who was a very maternal figure. Gilbert and George became regulars. Tracy went there, Angus Fairhurst, Sarah Lucas, everybody. Tracey Emin, artist. Cool Britannia was a real thing, and it was a good thing.
Jefferson Hack. Rankin and I were in the right place at the right time. John Savage, journalist. Blair, who had tinkered with A New British Image in 1993, developed this London centricity on 1994's Park Life, an album that mixed the jauntiness of 1966 Kinks with the crunch of punk and early 80s cheesy electronica. In May 1994, Damon Albarn featured on the cover of The Face with a Union Jack. The cover strap, Brit Up Your Ears, recalled the title of John Lahr's famous Joe Orton biography and film.
Stuart McConey, journalist. I was in Japan with Blur on their Modern Life is Rubbish tour, and you could sense something was happening.
Nikki Carter, artist. Britain went global. I was sitting in the Groucho one day and decided to go to Damien's first show in New York. I literally had a toothbrush and passport. I didn't know where I was going to stay, but Alex James picked me up from JFK in his limo and took me along to the hotel where Keith Allen was waiting with Damien. It was a very long couple of days. Courtney Love, musician. Sam Taylor Wood brought me into Jay Joplin's world, and I met Tracy, Lightly, Sarah Lucas. That was 90s shit right there. Sam introduced me to Lee McQueen. It was a mad time. I loved the girls. I didn't give a fuck about Damien. I loved the girls.
Alistair Campbell. England hadn't won a major tournament since 1966, and England was not a footballing superpower in the way maybe it thought it was, but the Premier League was. If you think about who in that period was the most famous footballer in the world, it was David Beckham. the most famous football team, it was Manchester United. Then consider the Beatles and the Stones, who laid the groundwork. Every Oasis song you hear something original, but it's actually built on something that feels very Beatles. The culture and the arts gave an energy to that political moment, and it became very powerful.
David Beckham, footballer and entrepreneur. I really enjoyed working with people like David LaChapelle, Stephen Klein, and Merton Marcus. They were all great opportunities. There was never any agenda to anything I did. I just saw an opportunity to work with great people and do something different. And I wasn't scared to do it. Elga Johnson, journalist. The term Britpop was ubiquitous, encompassing a sound and style that projected Cool Britannia in a major way for the first time since Carnaby Street was the centre of the world in the 60s. Oasis, Blur, Suede and Elastica dominated the airwaves. Songs about sitting at home and having a cup of tea and going shopping for food like common people had never been so essential. It wasn't just the everyday Joe who wanted to be in a band and drink at the Good Mixer in Camden. Even politicians fancied themselves as rock and roll stars. Labour's Spinal Tap-style leader, Tony Blair, decided this was the moment to remind everyone he once played an instrument, in sharp contrast to the not-so-rock-and-roll John Major. Oswald Boateng, fashion designer.
The interest rate hike at the start of the decade was tough for everyone, but creativity started to bubble. First, it was Kate Moss and Corinne Day and the grunge thing, then the music, and obviously the arrival of Tony Blair. Tony was coming with a new form of politics, which was saying, I'm going to be about both right and left. We'd never had that before. Plus, he was young. It wasn't an image we were used to seeing, and he represented a new politics, a new way of being in Britain.
Steve McQueen, artist and filmmaker.
I heard about Acid House around 1988. Before that, it was the time of pirate radio, Kiss FM, Norman Jay and Jazzy B. But in 88, the retro thing gave way to Acid House. My first experience of it was in 1989 at the Astoria in Charing Cross Road when I was 19. This guy came up to me, who I recognised as an older brother of a friend of mine at school. I was shocked when he spoke to me and said, "All right, Steve, are you on one?" For me, that's when it started. The clubs at the time were amazing, as was London. Freeze happened around the same time, in July 88, and it felt like this was the result of all these working-class kids having access to things. Going to art school, forming bands, becoming DJs, and talking about ideas. The 90s were similar to the 60s because there were possibilities, and that was very exciting. Cheap travel was coming in with EasyJet, British Midland, and Ryanair. There was an accessibility we'd never had before. We were travelling to France and Germany, and if it wasn't Luxembourg, it was Norway. Suddenly, for working-class people, there was a moment of possibility. When you could be a postman and you're hanging out with Tara from some blue blood family in Knightsbridge, seeing how the other half live. I used to love the exhilaration of dancing, just the sound of the music and moving your body. It was theatre, and it was another dimension, but it was real. The Astoria. Heaven. If you happened to get to go to a great warehouse party, it was like utopia. Then came jungle, which was more associated with sound systems of the 70s and early 80s, picking up from house music and mixing it with dub. This was the biggest revolution in music of the 90s, not retro Britpop. But the press around jungle was not favourable, to say the least. It was seen as aggressive and dark.
David Hepworth, journalist and author. When people talk about record company excess, they always talk about the 60s and 70s, but the early 90s was actually the period of the greatest excess. CDs cost £13, and within that cost there was quite a lot of money to spend on marketing, so it generated a huge amount of employment for all kinds of people. People in shops, in manufacturing, driving vans, writing for music magazines, absolutely everybody. So it was a very good time in that sense.
Michael Bracewell. In Britain, throughout the 90s, there was a fetish for Britishness itself. A brand of Britishness, in fact, which probably reached its apotheosis in the trend for young British art, Britpop, and all-round Britness. In this regard, the 90s were a rerun, in the UK, of the 60s. One kept expecting to find young men dressed as John Lennon doing the frog beside tap-dancing policemen. In this regard, the official Brit culture of the 90s, all those geezer novels about colourful East End gangsters and all those chick-lit flicks about lovable, ditzy single women, all those ironic young artists being ironically shocking, and all those groups who sounded like the Beatles might sound if you heard the Beatles being played on a small transistor radio through a thick wall, included the most conservative aspects of contemporary culture during the decade. Part nostalgia for a cultural imperialism which had the temper of a musical comedy, and part a clammy kind of nostalgia for some ancient idea of a less complicated society, all dizzy dolly birds and cheeky chaps.
Michael Craig Martin, artist. This was an explosion of talent that hadn't been seen since the 60s, and the 90s was a phenomenally creative time. Many of those young artists had friends in the other arts who were aware of what was happening in art and sought to emulate that success in their own fields: design, music, dance, performance, architecture. There was a very new sense of commonality and cooperation between all the creative sectors. The most exciting thing about the period was the palpable sense of possibility.
Sadie Coles. It was an unbelievably important time for art in Britain. At the end of that decade, Tate Modern opened. We didn't have a National Contemporary Museum before that. The YBA activity definitely encouraged that to happen. We had Frieze, and that was established in London. The USP of Frieze is young and emerging art, and it helped establish London as a major global player for young and emerging contemporary art. At the end of that decade, the auction houses made London their number two priority after New York, which was a big deal. All the auction houses ramped up their presence here because of the significance of the market, which was being driven by all of this activity. The number of galleries in one decade went from a handful of important international respected dealers to hundreds. We wouldn't have had a Hauser and Worth here if it wasn't for the fact the 90s created a viable art market.
Paul Smith, fashion designer. I'm old enough to remember the swinging 60s, and it was almost like an equivalent to that, but with a new title. Everyone wanted to come to London, so it was great for business. You had Kate Moss and Naomi Campbell, and everyone was talking about British fashion. But the thing that worked for us was skinny suits. Everything had been baggy up until then. Rave music, grunge, floppy sweaters. We made sharp, sexy 60s suits, and we couldn't make enough of them. We also did very well with the Union Jack, as that came back in a big way. We used it on so many things which I had originally done when I first started out in the 60s, when we sold T-shirts with the flag on. We started putting on T-shirts again, on handkerchiefs, on everything. For me, it was quite interesting to see it return, as it indicated a sort of resurgence of patriotism. It played especially well in Japan, where British designers had always done well.
Goldie, musician. I ran to rave and street culture because it was the only mother and father I really had. Then, along came the 90s, and it was all about freedom to party. And it was a really big thing pre-internet.
Alistair Campbell. People think Cool Britannia was a label we promoted. We didn't. It was a headline in Newsweek, and it just sort of stuck. That was the synthesis of something that was just evolving.
Alex James, musician and farmer. Hedonism was the context for the whole decade. We were all lurching towards 1999, heading towards this massive watershed moment. I mean, what a brilliant time to be young. I was in a band, and what the fuck are you going to do to try and enjoy yourself? It's the whole fucking point to have a good time. Oliver Payton, owner of the Atlantic Bar and Grill. At the time, London was full of people just starting out on their journey. Designers, artists, writers, actors. The city was blossoming. You felt anything was possible. London announced itself as the best city in the world, and I don't think it's ever lost that feeling. All of a sudden, city boys wanted to work in London because it was the place to be. People who had a choice between working here or New York would choose London. New York used to be the city where I went for inspiration, but after a while you'd go there and think, is this all there is? Alan Edwards, publicist and manager. There was so much coke around that after a while you didn't mention it. You didn't notice it. There were piles of it everywhere you went. If you went to an award show, every executive would be off to the toilet every 5 minutes. I mean, everyone seemed to be incontinent. Everyone was in the toilet. Everyone did it the whole time. I was probably the only one who was straight.
Tracey Emin. Everyone took drugs apart from me and Tony Blair.
It was a fairly typical night at a fashionable members' club in deepest Soho. Two famous comedians, one notorious contemporary artist, and the lead singer of an enormously popular Britpop band had just disappeared into a cubicle in the men's loos, not to write a pop song or a TV sketch, not to draw up contracts for a new media collective, nor to discuss the demise of a television programme. No, these four famous men were huddled together for the sole purpose of taking cocaine. I do so much these days, said one of the comedians, that when I go to the cash point, the notes come out already rolled. By 1995, cocaine was everywhere. It was certainly the drug of choice in London's pubs, nightclubs and private members' clubs, from Notting Hill to Bow Quarter, not to mention in the city's square mile. It's frightening. Richard Benson, the editor of The Face, told me at the time, you can't go anywhere these days, not have it shoved at you. By 1995, cocaine had become the binding agent of what many at the time were calling Swinging London 2, a so-called classless, or at least class-variable drug, which had managed to bring the worlds of pop, art, film and fashion, not to mention the building trade, together once again. Cafe society had never had it so good. Well, not for about 30 years it hadn't. The predominant reason for this groundswell of hedonism and creativity wasn't just more efficient drug supply chains. It was the resuscitation of British pop music. For the first 4 years of the 90s, the only music which somehow captured the spirit of the times had been grunge, with nihilistic rock groups such as Nirvana, Soundgarden and Pearl Jam reflecting the apathetic nature of young America, and consequently, young Britain. To quote Damon Albarn, if you weren't Nirvana, or a diet Nirvana, you were nothing. British rock was almost non-existent. But 1994 had brought something of a sea change, as the release of Blur's monumental album Park Life coincided with the birth of the New Lad, an idea born in Arena magazine, which would soon find a home in James Brown's Loaded. British teenagers started dressing up again and began to take notice of the dozens of young white British guitar groups waiting in the wings. Suddenly America looked comparatively antique. Of course, all of this was abetted by the untimely and tragic suicide of Kurt Cobain. On April the 8th, 1994, Cobain was found dead at his home in Seattle at the age of 27. Police concluded he had died on April the 5th from a self-inflicted shotgun wound to the head. Many critics would start saying Cobain's tragic death foreshadowed Britpop.
Andrew Harrison, journalist. Britpop was also a huge reaction to the death, the suicide, of Kurt Cobain. You know, I hate myself, but I want to die.
When Britpop happened, there was definitely something in the air, said Adrian Devoy, at the time a contributing editor of the music magazine Q. After the release of Blur's Park Life, British music seemed to become fun again. People began dressing better, and you certainly felt that something was going to come off. Music became an important part of people's lives again. In May that year, The Face put Blur on its cover, along with a Union Jack, itself a steal of a similar select cover from February 1993, with Suede's Brett Anderson unwittingly standing in front of the same flag. And things began to make sense. As it developed, Britpop became a potent Valentine to the 60s, a decade that eventually became a lodestar of post-war pop culture. The 90s almost seemed to be the 60s on steroids. Yes, there was an incongruence between the modernity of Britpop and the almost wistful hankering for the 60s. But then maybe that was the point. In the UK, regardless of whether you grew up during the 60s, you grew up with the 60s, not least because all those who were here and cutely claimed not to remember it nevertheless wouldn't shut up about how great it was, says the critic Andy Mill. Meanwhile, in the world of fashion, Britain's early 90s love affair with US style, down at heel grunge, was beginning to wane. For the previous five or six seasons, grunge had taken over the runway, adopted by stylists and designers anxious not to be left behind. But grunge, by definition, did little for fashion sales. It was time for the British fashion industry to come up with something new, a conscious return to glamour, orchestrated with great success by Robin Derrick, then the art director of British Vogue. In 1994, there was only one way for things to go, Derrick says. You could feel there was a change in the air, not just on the street, but also within the industry too. It was a time for something fresh, something glamorous to reflect what was going on in London. Fashion was becoming more upbeat, more sexual. Britpop was about to happen in a big way, and London seemed exciting again for the first time in years. As for press attention, the London art world had not seen anything like it, with Damien Hirst, Mark Quinn, Tracey Emin, and the other young British artists generating banner tabloid headlines all over the world with their sensationalist work. Dead sheep and formaldehyde, a human bust filled with blood, and a tent appliqued with the names of everyone Emin had ever slept with. At the time, a huge exhibition of British artists was running in Minneapolis called Brilliant, New Art from London, including work by Hirst, Emin, Sarah Lucas, and Jake and Dinos Chapman, to name only a few. The whole British scene is totally exportable, the gallerist Sadie Coles told me at the time. It's gaining momentum week by week. The great thing is that not only has this attention made stars out of people like Damien, but it has forced critics from all over the world to cast their net a bit wider and take into account some of the younger artists in London. The whole thing's just starting, and art has rediscovered its power to shock. If you judged how much London swung by the amount of attention it created abroad, then the flashpoints were easy to see. It first happened in 1966-67, when London was rubber-stamped as the trendiest city in the Western Hemisphere. It happened again 10 years later in 1976-77, when punk rock reared its ugly peroxide head, and then again in 1983 with New Pop, the year in which over a third of American chart places were taken by British acts. And in 1995, it was happening all over again. If you picked up any major American newspaper, The arts and metro sections would have been full of references to London's resurgence as a fashion capital. Damien Hirst's awful delights, or the almost pan-global feud between the two new kings of pop, Oasis and Blur. Oasis coming straight from the terraces, and Blur walking through London's gull-clawed air, soaking up all the pre-zeitgeist cultural smugness. As was befitting of anyone caught up in the maelstrom, Richard Benson was suitably circumspect. Swinging London exists as much as it did in the 60s, but whether or not the 60s actually meant as much as it was supposed to is open to question. There is certainly a great deal of energy coming from London, and the cross-fertilisation is fantastic. Damien Hirst directing a Blur video, for example, but apart from that, it's a bit of a cliché. If you accept that the singer from Menswear, the guitarist from Pulp, and two enemy journalists playing pool in the Good Mixer, the trendy Britpop pub in Camden Town, is interesting, then you've got swinging London. It seemed to some that the major difference between the 60s and the 90s was marketing, and that this melting pot of cultures and cross-pollination of ideas was nothing more than a lot of grandstanding by another generation of uppity Renaissance lads. In one respect, the 90s started with something of a full stop. As we slipped into the new decade, Margaret Thatcher was already starting to lose her authority. The country had become used to her authoritarian ways, but her party was beginning to tire of her, driven by the public's denunciation of the poll tax. After a sudden leadership challenge by Michael Heseltine, John Major, a relatively recent cabinet arrival, won the party's backing, becoming Prime Minister in November 1990. But while Thatcher might have gone, her legacy was still with us, and the huge economic boom of the 80s was, perhaps inevitably, on the downward curve, eventually pushing the country into recession. The debt accumulations of the 80s were compounded by the jump in oil prices after Iraq invaded Kuwait, and the enormous hikes in domestic interest rates. Politically, Major was hampered by his reliance on the UK's adherence to the European Exchange Rate Mechanism, and the country's withdrawal from it in September 1992 made him a moving target. Many had had enough of him already. One of the most important changes with Major was a genuine understanding that the country needed healing, and that the disparity between rich and poor was becoming untenable. Socially, at least, after Thatcher's unceremonious ousting, it looked as though Britain had reached what many considered at the time to be a crossroads. If you were part of the new leisure class, you had probably found your way to a gated community, and if you weren't, you were probably still in a sinker state. After a decade of often bitter social, cultural, and economic conflict, there was a sense that perhaps the 90s might become a more benevolent decade. There was very much a sense that what the country might be yearning for might now be delivered. Society. John Major even said as much when he entered Number 10, promising to create a classless society, which he described as a tapestry of talents in which everyone from child to adult respects achievement. He was still talking about it in his party conference speech the following year. "I spoke of a classless society. I don't shrink from that phrase. I don't mean a society in which everyone is the same, or thinks the same, or earns the same, but a tapestry of talents in which everyone from child to adult respects achievement, where every promotion, every certificate is respected, and each person's contribution is valued." This certainly didn't sound like the Conservative Party of the 80s. But there was little belief that Major could actually deliver what he espoused. The country was still riven with inequality, but culturally the decade started to pivot almost immediately. The country would start to forge a new sense of not just what it meant to be British, but also how it felt. There are circumstantial reasons for all of the cultural activity in the early parts of the 90s, although a lot of it was a direct consequence of being young and ambitious. Luck played a part, as did expediency, and many of the cultural micro-nudges were in direct response to what had immediately come before, but so much of creative endeavour is forged by youth and enthusiasm, and it was no different in the 90s. Of course, more than a few industry figures were ventriloquised by the new regime. But largely, Britpop was a tremendous celebration of being young-ish and creative. Take Oasis. Noel Gallagher's band succeeded on the strength of brutal execution and a constant, bright-eyed attention to craft. Their first album, Definitely Maybe, was 50 minutes, which evaporated in five-minute bursts of noise. Great rock music that sounded not unlike a lot of rock music you'd heard before, but somehow better, more confident. Even as it embraced the present, much of Oasis's music seemed to be a negotiation with the past, reinterpreting pop's greatest hits for the contemporary world. Their rock and roll blueprint, based on many previous rock and roll blueprints, was so well defined, it almost became an orthodoxy for the whole period. That it didn't is a testament to art school renegades like Jarvis Cocker and Blur's Alex James, who were determined to make their moment in the limelight as culturally resonant as possible. Even so, the period produced great stars. Whether you were a YBA or a guitarist, a young actor or a fledgling journalist, Cool Britannia became one massive billboard for their collective charisma. After a while, it all started to feel like it was part of something bigger. The relationship between media, entertainment, and politics was beginning to change. There was a revolution happening in the structural and cultural development of football, while the film, radio, and television industries were starting to be filled with the same state-educated wunderkinds who were invading the music world.
Gary Young, journalist. The alliance between pop and politics isn't simply self-serving. It usually represents a genuine confluence between sentiment and political expression. Harold Wilson's photo opportunity with the Beatles was symbolic of the new modern era when the white heat of technology would transform both our economy and our culture. Billy Bragg's Red Wedge tapped into a general feeling of disenfranchisement among young Britain during the Thatcher period. Cool Britannia had its roots in a new beginning after 18 years of Thatcherism.
Alan McGee. When I first saw Oasis at King Tut's, I could not believe my eyes. They had one USP after another. First of all, Liam Gallagher was fucking good looking. He was like a young Paul Weller in an Adidas top. Number two, they could play well. And number three, they had great songs.
McGee, the head of Creation Records, instinctively hated Margaret Thatcher and everything she stood for. Although he was smart enough to know, although perhaps ill-advised to say so, that he was absolutely a product of Thatcherism. Politics, he could reject. Music, he could finesse. And while he had spent his career finessing his roster, with Oasis, everything fell into his lap. It's perfectly acceptable to say that Britpop began on May the 31st, 1993, when McGee dropped in at King Tut's Wah Wah Hut, a club in Glasgow and the site of an Old Saints and Sinners pub. He was there to see a potential Creation signing, 18 Wheeler, and ended up watching a band who, while they weren't on the bill, were demanding to play. Worried that if they didn't acquiesce, it might all go off. The management allowed them to play a short set. They were called Oasis, and McGee couldn't take his eyes off the singer.
There were 12 people there, and he was just giving it to everybody.
After they played four songs, Rock and Roll Star, Bring It On Down, Up in the Sky, and I Am the Walrus, he was determined to sign them. His team, however, were less enthusiastic, thinking McGee was about to lumber them with yet another Mancunian band when Mancunian bands were rapidly going out of fashion. The music papers were getting into Suede or whatever, and it was all going a bit more art school,
rather than baggy jumpers and just standing there looking aggressive, said a friend.
Alan McGee. The first time I saw Oasis, I thought Liam was their drug dealer. He was too good-looking to be their singer. I turned up to find the band kicking off, trying to get on stage, actually trying to get on the bill. They weren't meant to play at all. There were at least 10 or 12 skanky manks loping about, but in the corner was one really good-looking kid that I suppose looked a bit like George Harrison or George Best in an Adidas tracksuit. He had to be 19, 20. I was big into ecstasy and cocaine and a total cynic, and I looked and went, well, that's got to be the drug dealer, because people in bands weren't that good looking. Then I looked at Bonehead and I thought, he's the singer. Liam was good looking and he could sing. He was a textbook fucking rock star. Noel had great songs and it was fucking perfection. The most mystifying part of that whole thing was how come nobody had signed them. They had done 26 shows before I saw them, and yet nobody had signed them. How come nobody else saw it? The music business had passed on it. Oasis had done the In the City festival the previous year, and no one was interested. I mean, all I was doing was saying yes.
Steve Sutherland, journalist. I remember when I was with Melody Maker, McGee barged into the office one day, as mad as he is, and said he's got the greatest band in the world, and he took me to see the Jesus and Mary Chain. And he was right. A few years later, I got another call. Do you remember the last time I called about a band? Well, I've done it again. So, I went to see them, and he was right. So, we gave Oasis their first cover.
Stuart McConey. When Oasis emerged, they were actually what I considered to be slightly more conventional meat and potatoes rock and roll, not the quirky, indie, arty alternative thing at the beginning.
Jefferson Hack. I remember Alan calling me up and telling me he'd just signed a band who were going to be the biggest band in the world.
Alan McGee. What did I bring to Oasis? Well, at the time, Creation was quite a hip label, which had Primal Scream, My Bloody Valentine, and Teenage Fan Club, so I suppose we were bringing some credibility and selling a lot of records. But we didn't know Oasis were going to be bigger than that. I thought Oasis were maybe just like these other three bands that are indie big and sell maximum a million records.
Liam Gallagher, singer. Those were the fucking days, man. Sharing rooms, lots of drinking, just never-ending nights. Do you know what I mean? Just feeling invincible, never really worrying about singing or any of that. I don't think I ever warmed up once. I'd just be backstage, stoned, and someone goes, right, you're on, and that would be it. Not that professional, to be fair, which was good at the time. It's when you go into arenas that you start thinking, fucking hell, I've got to hold it down a bit.
Kevin Cummins, photographer. The rise of Oasis was meteoric, completely off kilter with everything else that was going on. We did a tour with them in March 1994, and they were already too big for the venues they'd been booked into. They were also perfect for the music papers because they just said anything they felt like saying, and obviously that's what you love when you work for a music paper. They were gobshites, basically. In February, Creation had asked me if I'd take some pictures of them to get the band used to being photographed, so they sent me to Amsterdam where they were supporting the Verve. But when I got there, the only one who was there was Noel. I asked him if the others were still out from the night before, and he said no, they'd been arrested. They travelled on the ferry and had been in a fight with some West Ham fans, been arrested and sent back to the UK. In the early days, they were great to photograph, cocky but likeable, and we all supported Man City. They weren't like a band who would turn up on time and do exactly what you told them to do. We did some pictures in Soho, and as we were crossing Oxford Street, Liam just jumped on a bus and hung off the back of it because he thought that was what the Beatles would have done. It was like herding cats, trying to keep them all together.
but I'd previously worked with the Happy Mondays, so I knew the score. Never have more than three people in your band, otherwise it's a nightmare. Liam Gallagher. My dad was a part-time DJ in the Irish bars, so we'd have a nice big sound system and all these records. We'd be coming in from school watching Grange Hill or waiting for Top of the Pops, and he'd be recording his records onto tape. You'd be going, "But Top of the Pops is on, you cunt." Then he'd go and play these tapes in the Irish joints. We'd be there. We were his roadies, I guess. Then Noel started playing guitar. My old fella had a guitar. I think that's when Noel started picking it up. My older brother Paul was into the Jam and the Beat, the Selector, UB40. Noel was more into punk, and I'm sharing a room with Noel, so I'm getting all that. Paul's stuff felt more normal, whereas the Damned and the Pistols, for a 13-year-old, was a bit, "What's all this scary shit?" The Smiths came along, and I thought, "This is pretty good, but a bit studenty." Then the Roses came along, and that was it. They looked like a lot of the lads from round our way. Ian Brown wasn't a particularly good singer, but I thought I could do that. They were my epiphany. I went to see the Roses in 89 at the Manchester International 2, and I remember going home from the gig thinking, I ain't gonna work, I'm gonna get a band. The Roses' music was all about movement. Every time I put the Roses' tunes on, it was sunny, you know? Even though they were from Manchester, it was like, how are they making this music in this fucking gloomy, rainy city? Parallel universes. It's pissing down outside. The sounds are taking you somewhere else. I can put that first album on and I remember what I was wearing, who I was hanging out with, what weed I was smoking, what score City were getting battered by.
Tony Parsons, journalist and author. Before they were tabloid stars, the brothers were the embodiment of a certain strain of British rock, the kind that never went to art school and never learned to behave in polite society. It always gets embarrassing after a year or two and seems yobbish and stupid. But when Definitely Maybe came out, it felt like Liam and Noel were doing nothing less than saving rock and roll.
Alan McGee. In the beginning, I was really involved in the recording sessions, as I wanted to make sure what they were doing was what they should be doing. I also rejected the first recording of Definitely Maybe because it wasn't good enough. They had to do it again. I went off to Hawaii for my first holiday in years with my girlfriend Belinda at the time, and then Noel sent over Live Forever, and I was like, fuck, this is really good. And I realized then that he was a great writer. Then I heard Supersonic and I couldn't believe it. I actually questioned whether Noel had written it himself. I think at that point I was like, it's more than just the Manchester thing, which is why I had originally liked them. I really thought they were just a Manchester band. When I played their tape to Sony Publishing, they said, Alan, Manchester's over. In 7 days, they had sold 365,000 copies of the album, which was unheard of. That's platinum. In 1 week, I don't think Creation had ever had a number one before. It was just a fucking mad time.
Kevin Cummins. In 1990, I was still at the NME doing about half the covers a year. Blur had already been through a couple of earlier incarnations, so by 1993 they were quite well established. Then Suede came along and were a little bit different. We still didn't use Britpop as a term. I don't think anybody used it until Select put Suede on the cover with a Union flag. But Britpop wasn't a thing until Oasis came along, and then, suddenly, it was.
Mark Ellen, journalist. A lot of their appeal was down to their lack of pretension. They were militantly against any form of artifice. They wore the same clothes off stage as on. Liam's idea of stagecraft was to sit on the drum riser during guitar solos and smoke and drink lager. I interviewed Noel in October 94 for Mojo and was entranced by him. There was absolutely no side to him at all. What you saw was what you got. I never met a musician like him. Most of them tend to go to great lengths to convince you their songs have enormous depth and resonance and are 100% original, or that they're lucky enough to be some sort of divinely selected conduit through which music can be channeled from the celestial cloud or some such. But he rattled off a list of the people he'd brazenly ripped off to write the first Oasis album. He told me Shaker Maker was stolen from The New Seekers and Flying by the Beatles. Cigarettes and Alcohol was stolen from T-Rex. He wasn't remotely self-conscious about what was or wasn't fashionable. His favourite songs included Car Trouble by Adam and the Ants, To Love Somebody by the Bee Gees, SOS by ABBA, and One by U2. He said he was still trying to rip off Don't Dream It's Over by Crowded House. When I suggested it was very honest of him to admit this, he said, "There are 12 notes in the scale and 36 chords, and that's the end of it," and that everyone stole from everyone else. The Beatles had the Shirelles over on many an occasion. He stole stuff, and he didn't care if he was sued for it. And he said that, apart from Slide Away and Live Forever and Married with Children, which I wrote for an ex-girlfriend, none of my songs mean anything. He was perfectly happy to tell the world his lyrics were meaningless and a lot of his chord sequences were nicked. And I loved and admired his honesty. It seemed so refreshing.
Alan McGee. After a while, I could tell Oasis had the same ambition as you two.
Oasis became so big so quickly that they soon became a band that induced nostalgia for itself. The form and the imagery spread like a virus, but then so did the sensibility, a cocky exuberance that treated culture, pop culture, music, art, a type of politics, almost as its own class. Britain was as obsessed with class in the 90s as it had always been, despite what John Major said, and this was ruthlessly exploited by many of Britpop's prime exponents, almost using class as Britpop's very own motif. Even so, Britpop itself felt like a class apart. So quickly did cool Britannia become ingrained in the culture that it became an alternative tourist attraction. Come to London, use a phone box, take a black cab, meet a monkey-booted member of a Britpop band or a snivelling YBA at the Good Mixer. There was also something determinedly good-natured about the time. If you looked at the images of punks in the 70s, you saw a lot of grimacing and anger. And if you did the same in the studied, sometimes cooler than now 80s, you would be met with couldn't-care-less stares. But in the 90s, much like the 60s, people smiled, laughed, and looked as though they couldn't believe their luck. Whether they were swinging from a mirror ball in a provincial nightclub or rolling around the floor in Soho's trendy Groucho Club. For some, the rolling around got a little too much. Alan McGee's drug use was already in fourth gear by the time he discovered Oasis. He had moved from ecstasy to cocaine, and in 1992 even started freebasing coke. McGee tells a story of one particular party after Primal Scream won the first Mercury Prize, the Screamadelica, in 1992. Apparently, cocaine was laid out in a pyramid the size of a sandcastle on the table, and everyone was just digging into it with teaspoons and throwing it up their noses. Even the signing of Oasis had a narcotic flavour to it, with lines of cocaine being offered along with biros. Hanging out with Oasis was exhausting. I go from one night with Liam and Noel to a night out with Primal Scream. I'd be down in Wales with Oasis recording the album, doing drugs every night. They'd arrive in London, and I'd go on another two-dayer with them. By the time Oasis were preparing to release Definitely Maybe, McGee was in rehab and would go on to spend 6 weeks in the Nightingale Hospital in North London.
Tony Parsons. The Sex Pistols, for example, had real yobbish tendencies, probably far worse than Oasis.
but you cut people some slack when you're taking drugs with them. I didn't have that relationship with Oasis, and so I just looked at them and just saw a bunch of Manx. But I really loved that first Oasis album, and there was a sense that the ejaculation could never be that strong again. They'd put their 10,000 hours in, or close to it, like the Beatles had done in the Reaper Barn, like the punk bands did at the 100 Club. There was something fundamentally Neanderthal about Oasis, but I loved them.
Kevin Cummins. Any time Noel Gallagher spoke, it was confrontational. I went to LA with Oasis once to do a piece on them, and they were on stage for 8 minutes and they'd already had two fights. Then they just disappeared, with Noel exiting stage left and Liam stage right, never to be seen again. Which is great for the writer, but it's not too good for photographers. But I want rock stars to behave like rock stars. I want them to do ludicrous things, and Oasis did. Noel says they were the last analog band. These days, if you walk on stage, nobody's looking at you, they're all looking at the back of their phones. In 1994, you couldn't avoid Oasis when they came on stage.
Dorian Linsky, journalist. Think of 1994 as the launch ramp when Park Life and Definitely Maybe established the newly christened Britpop as a gathering wave which carried alternative rock from the fringes to the centre. In its wake, 1995 was the year of liftoff. Better? Arguably. Bigger? Without a doubt. For people who had grown up in the 80s, feeling shut out both culturally and politically, it was as if a historical injustice were being rectified. What if you could dethrone Wet 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 and John Major? What if your team could win for once? It really, really, really could happen.
Oasis was soon so big and so obviously ambitious that 1995 was almost predetermined to be their year. But there was a lot of noise around them, and a lot of cultural tributaries occupied by artists who'd come up with them and in many cases been around before them, shoulder-barging grunge with as much decorum as they could muster. There were correspondences everywhere. Before Oasis, there was Suede, Blur, Pulp, three soon-to-be iconic Britpop bands who had all started way before Oasis. Radiohead were another proto-Britpop group. They released their single Creep at the end of 1992, but it wasn't a hit until it was re-released a year later. Although the band were quintessentially British, Creep appeared to borrow elements from the Hollies song The Air That I Breathe, which eventually resulted in legal action. This song in particular was more of a slacker anthem than anything else, not unlike Beck's Loser, or the band singer, Tom York, always took exception to their Britpop tag. Starting out as a sort of thinking man's Brit Nirvana, they quickly rubber-stamped themselves as the sullen flip side of Britpop, a raggle-taggle band of grumpy, bedsit sonic innovators. And while their guitarist, Johnny Greenwood, might have had cheekbones that could have started a war, York's voice was described as a tired snarl, a reedy drone, and a light falsetto. Radiohead World was like the Truman Show, an enormous artificial dome where instead of Sea Haven, you had one giant halls of residence, with hundreds of different types of mournful, ambient music seeping out from under each door. They always understood their constituency extremely well, aware that every move they made was subject to the ridiculously high standards of their fans. The band had integrity thrust upon them ever since they started, and they knew their success was based on them living up to expectations. They might have said, as all artists do, that they were determined to live up to their own high standards, but that was a fallacy. Radiohead were successful because their supporters believed they cared more than anyone else about what it was they did. Another Britpop harbinger were Primal Scream, a
a British rock group who embraced club culture with almost unbelievable fervour. Until they started recording Screamadelica, 1991, Primal Scream had been a fairly traditional rock band. After working with DJ Andrew Weatherall alongside veteran Rolling Stones producer Jimmy Miller, they turned into indie dance fiend extraordinaires, while leader Bobby Gillespie became a drug rock swami. Blur had been slightly ahead of the pack too, having released their first album, Leisure, in 1991. Their second single, There's No Other Way, was a massive hit, although it very much sounded like a record hailing from the last days of the 80s. It was Modern Life is Rubbish, 1993, that turned them into Britpop harbingers. Lyrically, it was full of suburban vignettes, accessorized by Graham Coxon's choppy guitar, Damon Albarn's whistly S's, and Alex James's Another Country Wedge. Park Life, the 1994 album that infused Britpop with a real sense of self, could easily have swayed into the arch. It was originally going to be called Soft Porn, with a photograph of Buckingham Palace on the cover, but Park Life was Britpop, and Britpop was Park Life. Lovingly described as owing as much to the cynicism of the kink 60s as it did to the emerging new lad culture of the 90s, the songs were as British as tea towels.
Alex James. It definitely wouldn't have happened without any one of us. The most difficult thing for a band to do is to meet the people you want to make music with. It was an incredible series of coincidences that led us to meet each other. It's all about having a group with people who all think they're the cleverest one. Damon was the one with the drive and a knack of getting things finished. Without him, me and Graham would be sitting round in student halls. But in those days, we all had a lot of energy. We knew we wanted it, whatever it was. We were totally convinced of our genius, but we're getting less and less so as the years go by. Tony Parsons. I'd been aware of Blur, had written about them, and liked them, but then they quickly became something else. I saw them live, and the crowd reaction was more Wham than the Sex Pistols. Girls liked them, which is not necessarily the case with rock bands. It was interesting because they were born a little bit too late for the kind of music they wanted to play. But then I heard the first Oasis album and was just blown away by it. And I loved the attention to detail, loved the picture of Bacharach on the cover. They were in Beatleland, in their private little universe, and because they were brothers, it all became more heightened as they so obviously needed each other. The frontman didn't write songs, and the brother who wrote the songs wasn't an obvious charismatic frontman. But together, it made sense. So, with Blur and Oasis, you've suddenly got one of those great stories that's just built for the British music press. Paul Weller, songwriter and musician. Britpop was a fun time. It was a messy time, though, because everyone was on loads of booze and the rest of it, me included. But it was a lot of fun. I thought the early 90s were quite good. Lots of great Britpop, and also hip-hop, R&B, and jazz too. It seemed like everyone was going out to see bands live again, and it felt like the last boom time for that in Britain. People wanting to go out was inspiring in itself.
Britpop had its heroes too. Those iconic British pop stars who had an affinity with London, or at least with the mediated version of the capital. In fact, Britpop couldn't have existed without its heroes, many of whom had first appeared in the 60s. One of the biggest Britpop heroes was Paul Weller, an individual who had single-handedly steered his way through at least three iterations of himself. And while he hailed from the 70s, he was as obsessed with the 60s as any member of Blur, Oasis, or Pulp.
Paul Weller,
I didn't really like being called the mod father or the godfather of Britpop, as I was only 32. It felt very odd. It was nice being appreciated after being so vilified for a number of years by the British press. Suddenly, I was all right again. Around the time of Wild Wood and Stanley Road, I had a lot of people around me going, "Amazing, amazing." And as far as I was concerned, this was just what I'd been doing for ages. It was funny that it connected with people in such a big way. There was no plan to do that whatsoever. I was quite happy with my level of fame before all the success of the mid-90s.
Another big hero was the Kinks' Ray Davies. Lauded by everyone from Damon Albarn to Pulp's Jarvis Cocker, and feted by critics for writing the sort of three-minute kitchen sink dramas that were by the 90s considered to be the cornerstone of great British pop. You couldn't escape him, as he was name-checked in every interview by every aspiring Britpop erevista. While Waterloo Sunset continued to regularly top lists of all-time favourite pop songs, you couldn't escape Davis's voice either and his trademark North London whine, with its nasal secondary modern lilt, had been copied by everyone from Albarn to, bizarrely, Liam Gallagher. Concentrating on tragicomic observation, Davis's songs revolved around predominantly male lower middle class aspirations, expressing his ambivalence towards wealth, fame, and class, and examining the strange mixture of predetermination and hazard to which human relationships are subject. The ordinary and the obvious were spelled out in his lyrics, but contrastingly, never in a manner that was either. For years, he was writing about what Saul Bellow called the melancholy of affluence, and suggested that modern life is rubbish when Damon Albarn was still in the playground. "I'm a grumpy suburbanite, and I think I've always been a grumpy old man," Davis told me at the time. "A lot of my early songs were written for an older generation, because I wrote those when I was 20, 21, 22. My sensibility has always been a bit old and grumpy, but a lot of people who know me really well say I'm very juvenile. One of the great characteristics of London is its grumpiness, rising above adversity. Everything's such a terrible struggle, but we get there. It's part of our siege mentality, bulldog spirit." When I quizzed him about his Britpop deification and the fealty that a lot of mid-90s bands displayed towards the Kinks, Davis said he'd been experiencing it for years, and that it had started in earnest during punk. "I don't think Johnny Rotten was trying to sound like me, but there was something in the imagery the music conjured up," he said. "There was that comic anger. I think Britpop celebrated the style of my writing. It was more to do with sensibility, Englishness, like park life, country house and things like that. They've all touched on different aspects of me. Certainly with the vocal style. I admire their ability to take conceptual ideas and turn them into something that's theirs. It's not theft in that respect, it's an inspirational thing." Weirdly, Davis also became a Britpop cliche because of the war of attrition he had with his brother and fellow Kink Dave. Over the years, there was little love lost between the siblings. In their day, the Davis brothers were more spiteful, more combative and more violent towards each other than even Liam and Noel Gallagher. In fact, compared to the Davis brothers, Liam and Noel's sibling rivalry was positively pedestrian. During the first two decades of the Davis's career, journalists lost count of the number of times they threw guitars at each other on stage. Dave once co-wrote a song called Hatred, a duet, featuring the line, "Hatred is the only thing that keeps us together." One night, while dining in a New York restaurant, Davis Jr. made the mistake of trying to steal one of his brother's French fries. Ray's response: he apparently stabbed his brother in the chest with his fork.
Ray Davis, musician and songwriter. I do think there's a lineage somewhere. but I think you'll probably find Damon Albarn got into the kinks because of his mum. I can understand people associating me with menswear and Blur because of their Englishness, but I actually hear more of the intent of the kinks music, rather than the application, in Oasis. There's a lot of the up against it thing that we did. Michael Bracewell. The promotion and appropriation of ideas of Englishness would also be a fetish in 90s pop and rock. Mark Ellen. I loved Blur and Oasis and Supergrass particularly. They had echoes of the music I'd grown up with. Beatles, Stones, Kinks. They looked so charismatic, which matters so much in the magazine world.
1995 would be full of these backward glances towards the 60s. Whether it was Jarvis Cocker echoing the style of a 1966 dandy, the YBA's rebooting the 60s underground tropes of happenings and shock, Premier League footballers starting to use George Best as a blueprint for success, or the publishing industry trying to tap into post-National Service exuberance, the last National Serviceman left the armed forces in May 1963. It is usually assumed that the men's magazine boom of the 90s was a natural development of the explosion of consumer magazines that had started a decade before. But in terms of the zeitgeist, it was part of a pattern that emerged during the freedoms of the 60s. Town was the first real men's lifestyle magazine created by Michael Heseltine in 1962.
Damien Hirst, artist. I thought if the Sex Pistols can get to number one, then you can do anything. It was perfect for me to be too young to be a punk, because I had to be devious about it. I had to carry a bag with all my clothes and then change at the bottom of the garden, then go to the bus stop. So in the art world, when people said to me, you can't do that, I was primed to do what I wanted to. I'd just say, what are the rules and how do we find a way around them? Because that was what it was all about for me, giving people what they didn't want in a way they couldn't refuse. I don't feel responsible for the period, although I feel influential within it in some way. But I don't know. It's difficult. It's like a tide, isn't it? It's like you're a wave and you're riding it. So you're not creating it, you're riding it. I think that once I saw trends and once I jumped on them, I helped them to be stronger. I was in the right place at the right time.
Tracey Emin. Because I didn't have any money, I was entrepreneurial. I photocopied all these forms, which I sold to people for £10 each, for which I promised to send them three letters. People would call it crowdfunding these days. The letters would be personal, stories, with little additions, photos. The first time I did it, I got 80 quid. I was going to write a book, sit at home and write, and become a writer, not be an artist. I didn't have a studio or anything. But somehow, my little project was an art form in itself. And I'd take forms out with me everywhere I went. I'd ride my bike to all the openings and try and sell my letters. The clever people kept them, and one of those people was Jay Jopling. He was already a sort of big-name person, but he always made time to talk to me about whatever I'd written for him, because then I wrote more to him because he responded, and we became friends. We're not friends in real time, friends to do with the letters, if that makes sense. And through my letters, people saw I wasn't what they thought I was, because I was really wild then. Anyone who thinks I've been wild, they should have seen me at the beginning of the 90s. I'd ride around in a miniskirt or velvet green hot pants with hobnail boots, Jesus sandals and socks and men's shirts. I just looked different. People in the art world used to call me Jaws because when I laughed, you could see all the metal in my mouth.
Dorian Linsky. For good or ill, Britpop ignited a new respect for the heritage of British rock, a strange alloy of youthful energy and cap-doffing nostalgia.
1995 was also a far more eclectic year musically than it has been given credit for. And in the same way Motown and urban dance music accompanied and often underpinned the rise of psychedelic pop in the 60s, so similar things happened in the 90s. In essence, nothing appeared to be happening in isolation. By 95, it was berserk, said Steve Lamack. You'd find a band 1 week, and 2 weeks later, they'd be on the Radio 1 playlist. Saint Etienne's Sarah Cracknell said, Britpop was simply a label given to the indie scene that was no longer underground or independent. I guess it developed once groups and major record companies started jumping on the bandwagon, but I don't think there is a specific line in the sand where it all started.
Andrew Harrison. With Suede, Blur and Pulp, we definitely felt as though something was happening. You started to see people dressing the same way, not just people in bands. We all shared the same sense of humour, and there was a real sense British culture was on the up and up. We liked old British telly, old British cinema, and people were talking about football again, because we'd just had Italia 90. And so it was almost as though football had been rebranded. People are drinking in the Good Mixer in Camden. At the same time, there is a huge club culture. And at exactly the same time Blur, Oasis and Suede are happening, so are Massive Attack and Underworld and Orbital. I guess the analogy is it's the 60s and the Stones and the Beatles are rattling around, but everyone is also dancing to Motown and Trojan. Echo Eschen, journalist. Club culture was interesting because it had moved on from being hermetic and Soho-based into a more sprawling, semi-spontaneous culture activity. This was also a period where you started to hear black voices come to the fore in a number of different ways, in music, in visual art, to some extent in filmmaking. I'm thinking about Isaac Julian doing Young Soul Rebels, for instance. More than anything, there's a confluence of these things. In one of my years at LSE, I spent a few months sharing a house with Brett and Matt from Suede, so I saw them evolving and starting their group and taking off. They were channeling the Bowie thing, but they were real scholars of music and of style, and had a real understanding of what that meant. They weren't particularly interested in authenticity, but they knew what they were doing. Of course, at the time, you also had the Daisy Age rap artists, A Tribe Called Quest, the Ruthless Rap Assassins, Definition of Sound, and lots of other acts who were spreading out of the hip-hop world. Dorian Linsky. As the age of the newly christened Super Club dawned, dance music was also feeling gung-ho. You've never had it so good, crowed Mixmag at the end of a year that saw debut albums from The Chemical Brothers, Left Field, Moby, David Holmes, and Goldie, the drum and bass scene's first pop star. The weekend starts here, announced Norman Cook's new alias, Fatboy Slim, and what a soundtrack those weekends had. Daft Punk's Da Funk, Faithless's Insomnia, Josh Wink's Higher State of Consciousness, the Todd Terry remix of Everything But the Girls' Missing, to name just a few. Away from the dance floor, Portishead won the Mercury Prize and Tricky blew minds with Maxine Key. Pulp bridged the gap and triggered an old-fashioned tabloid moral panic with the Proustian rave rush of Sorted for Ease and Whiz. Far from being siloed, the different scenes spoke to each other. One night at the Ministry of Sound ended with an MDMA-dazzled sing-along to Don't Look Back in Anger. Let's not forget that Noel was a former raver who ended up singing with both Goldie and the Chemical Brothers. The distance between metalheads and the Beatles wasn't as great as you might think.
Damien Hirst. If it hadn't have been for Charles Saatchi and the Saatchi Gallery, with that massive great space, I would have been another Peter Blake,
I would have made small things. I love Peter Blake, but as he did Sergeant Pepper, he probably can't work out why the Beatles are bigger than him, and I would have probably been in a similar boat. I suppose he didn't get on the wave, in a way. I feel lucky. There's certain stages of having a chair with your name written on it, and there are people trying to get you to sit in it, and if you sit in it, you're fucked. I feel really glad that I never sat in it. I never really had a plan, but I just wanted to change things and shake it up. By the beginning of the 90s, there was definitely a sort of go-get-it attitude that you saw in the world of advertising, but the art world was Cork Street, and a big painting was 4 foot across. I worked part-time at Anthony Doffe while at Goldsmiths, but even that was like a little shop. I used to hang pictures in the back room. It wasn't until I saw the Saatchi Gallery that I really thought, I'm going to make art for this space. That was when it went big for me. It was really exciting and it became global. Before that, the art world in London was small. I worked at Doffe with Sadie Coles, Lorcan O'Neill, Matthew Marks, Gavin Brown, who all went on to launch galleries. Everybody was there. It was crazy. I remember once being in the back room, which you couldn't leave if Anthony was with a client, but there was a viewing hole in the door so you could see what was going on. Anthony was sat in a chair, and he had an Eve Klein blue painting on the wall. It was like $200,000, which was tons of money at the time, and a client was on his knees begging to buy it. But because it was museum only, Anthony was just shaking his head. Everyone at Doffe went on to do something special, because art in the 90s just exploded. It all did.
Steve McQueen. In some respects, the 90s was an extraordinary decade. Of course, the Berlin Wall came down, but when Nelson Mandela came walking out of Robben Island, hand in hand with Winnie, with his fist in the air, was a highlight for me. Although I do remember people complaining that the BBC interrupted Antiques Roadshow to show it. In a sense, this, and the end of the Cold War, were echoes of the 60s, with the civil rights movement and women's rights. The sense of possibility in the 90s was really important. It was only a moment, and it didn't last for long, but it was important all the same. The 60s eventually came to an end, just as the 90s did, but both periods had this extraordinary sense of possibility and freedom and escape. Britain is about constant regeneration, which comes from post-war immigration, and that mixture of West Indians and the white working class. It's a sense of want and need, as well as a sense of anguish. You see it in people who want to get on, in a culture that pushes things forward, whether we see that in dub culture, from sound systems, The Clash, or house music and jungle in the 90s. It was all about fusion and experimentation. Being at Goldsmiths and having studied at Chelsea School of Art, I really believed there was a feeling of optimism. Art school was so important for me, as it was for so many people. Jefferson Hack. A lot happened in a very short space of time. Britpop, Brit art, Brit lit, Brit film, Brit everything. The battle between electronic music and rock bands, rock meets rave, Bristol, drum and bass, Goldie, Elastica. A huge DIY sensibility. Acid house creating an alternative economy. Optimism. The speed of everything was just so fast.
January. Kiss and make up. First, there was Suede. We had offers from major labels, but we skipped over them because we knew it was too early. We wanted to get the most out of every phase, like putting out a record on an independent label and playing small clubs, then doing bigger records and bigger tours. I think that just made us better prepared for this whole experience. Brett Anderson. January 1st. The Groucho Club's New Year's Day celebrations. Its membership committee
are increasingly mindful of the imminent launch of Nick Jones' rival Soho house just 50 yards away. January 1st. Serial killer Fred West is found hanged in his cell at Winston Green Prison in Birmingham, in advance of his trial for murdering up to 12 women and children, including two of his own daughters. January 1st, Britpop journalist John Harris turns 26. January 7th, the fifth Oasis single, Whatever, slips to number 6 in the official singles charts from a height of number 3. January 9th, Indolent Records release In Between Us by Sleeper. January 10th, the British football transfer fee record is broken when Manchester United signs striker Andy Cole from Newcastle United in a deal valued at £7 million. January 16th, Johnny Depp hosts a 21st birthday party for his girlfriend Kate Moss at LA's notorious Viper Room. January 24th, at the NME Awards, Blur win 5 gongs, Oasis win 3, and Alan McGee wins the Godlike Genius Award for services to music. January 25th, Eric Cantona, the French international forward, assaults a spectator after being sent off while playing for Manchester United in their match against Crystal Palace. 2 days later, United ban him from first-team football for the rest of the season. January 28th, comedian Frank Skinner turns 38. Also, a news piece in The Observer suggests the remaining Beatles are close to an agreement to commission a TV biopic, The Long and Winding Road, while Nick Hornby's Fever Pitch has helped recontextualize football in the media. Much to his annoyance, he is momentarily cast as a loaded character rather than the Woody Allen of Highbury.
Michael Bracewell. The story of Britpop all began with Suede's suburban urchin poetry of love, lust, and loneliness on the streets of contemporary London. Echo Eschen. The fashion at the beginning of the decade was all black and white grunge photography, the heroin chic thing. But that changed to something more about performance and presentation. And Suede had a lot to do with that, because it was all about an impatience with glamour. Damon Albarn, musician. When Kurt Cobain died, one of the things that surprised me was how upset everyone was, whatever their background. It showed me how fragmented the world is. Brett Anderson, musician. Despite what some people might assume, I never had a huge problem with grunge. At least those bands were expressing their reality and their worlds, and at its best moments, it contained a kind of truth and raw energy. I found it funny, though, that a whole generation thought they had invented a genre. But we all know creativity is just a process of synthesis, and nothing is completely original. The 90s was an especially postmodern decade in that respect, and even the era's most original genre, dance music, wasn't without provenance. Inevitably, the British press kind of pitted me against the grunge bands. The foppish cartoon version of myself that the haters had started to sketch seemed to neatly oppose the cartoon version of my opposite number, as it were. The lazy cliché of the English dandy versus the plaid-shirted slacker being too tempting for some journalists to resist. Ultimately, of course, the rivalry was a fake one, and the press soon lost interest in it once the hilariously bitchy Britpop wars began in earnest. Yes, I was aware the media's focus had shifted, but these were the days when cultural invention and reinvention had an ebbing, almost tidal quality, and nobody expected any movement to survive more than a few years. It's interesting to contrast this with the current cultural stasis in which we find ourselves.
stuck in a world where a vocal effect like auto-tuning has been de rigueur in mainstream pop for at least 20 years, and, amazingly, shows no signs of being challenged.
Courtney Love. In 1990, I wasn't so aware of music coming out of the UK. I didn't understand the Happy Mondays, as it was all dirty and shabby, and I didn't like the music. I liked My Bloody Valentine, and Loveless was an important record. It had great tones and textures. It was beautiful. But at the time, it was all about Sub Pop, all about the Northwest. Melody Makers Everett True is convinced he invented the word grunge, which is entirely possible. You guys in the UK had been using the word crusty for a while to describe Zodiac Mind Warp and all those guys, but in the early 90s, it was all about the US, about grunge. The breakout group was meant to be the U-Men, then Green River, the Soundgarden, then Mudhoney, and then it was Nirvana. It was the journalist Everett True who comes back to the UK with grunge, and then whatever happened there percolated until there was a demand for it. In the US, Nirvana started to get played on drive time radio, and they started to get all this press in the UK. So, then our daughter Frances was born in August of 92, and that's the month the Vanity Fair article on me and Kurt came out, and everything went crazy. The big deal was that, apparently, I was taking heroin while I was pregnant, but I was taking heroin until I found out I was pregnant. Then I stopped. The end. But it was the tone of the article that was so horrible. It was excoriating. It was written by Lynn Hirschberg. People warned me about her, but by then it was too late. The whole thing was rock star's baby born a junkie. But then the social workers at Cedars-Sinai launched an investigation into our parenting abilities, and everything went crazy. Custody, court, everything. Kurt was overdosing all the time, and it was horrible. So we had to deal with that. It was like a war with the media. Plus, there was no good science around Crohn's disease, which Kurt had, which made everything worse. I was the only one who believed him when he said what pain he was in, which is what killed him, ultimately. And the kind of attention he was getting at the time would have crushed anybody. The media. His illness. People trying to take our kid away. Plus, Kurt was the first person in the rock narrative to very deliberately take his life, as opposed to dying from a broken heart or heroin or whatever. That impacted on culture in a way that we don't even know yet. It makes him so cool. I mean, unless you were the one that had to clean up the blood that the coroner didn't. And that would be me. But I can detach from it and look at it culturally.
David Hepworth. Britpop was a rejection of 80s syndromes and sophistication, and it was also obviously a rejection of grunge.
John Savage. I'd finished writing England's Dreaming in the spring of 1990, and the first big story I did when I re-emerged was the Stone Roses at Spike Island for The Observer. I'd already seen them twice, once when they were very good in 1989, and then once in Stockholm. At Spike Island, I'd never seen so many stoned kids. It was like the major re-entry of marijuana into youth culture. Basically, it was very psychedelic. I don't know whether they were doing E or not, but the stink of weed in the audience was amazing. And the Stone Roses just weren't very good. They did not seem able to deal with the level of attention they were getting, and they burned themselves out very quickly. Then, of course, in 91, you had those two wonderful rock records, Nirvana's Nevermind and My Bloody Valentine's Loveless, both of which I was totally obsessed with. I saw My Bloody Valentine, and I just thought they were completely astonishing and super loud, so they are probably one of the reasons I got tinnitus. Nirvana, I was very emotionally invested in, I remember sitting in my car in Maida Vale, playing Nevermind to Brian Eno, and he was pretty stunned as well. The music was brutal. Then, in 93, I was offered an interview with Kurt and flew to New York to see them play Roseland. On the trip, I met Courtney Love, who I really liked. Everybody was slagging her off at the time, but I really liked her. At that point, she reminded me a lot of the women I'd met in the punk period. She'd wear the aggression on her sleeve, and then, once you got through that, she was really nice and easy and interesting. I thought she had a brain. Eventually, after hanging around with her and Kurt for 4 hours, we did this great interview that went on half the night. It was one of those times, and I've had very few of these, where time just stops, and it's just the two of you, and it's quite intense. He was sharp, funny, sarcastic, and because I didn't know about opiates, I didn't really go very deeply into the fact that he was a junkie. He wanted to talk about Derek Jarman, and I thought, hello, is this a way of actually saying you're gay? Anyway, he overdosed the next day, but recovered in time to play Roseland. It wasn't a very good show, as he was obviously still half dead, poor thing. Then, when Kurt died in early 94, I was really upset, because I'd been very invested in them. And then, I heard Suede. Brett Anderson. The Beatles, David Bowie, and the Kinks were the originators of Britpop. Suede relit a torch that had been sitting in a cupboard for a while.
Jarvis Cocker, musician. Stereolab and Suede had started, and we played some concerts with them and got to meet some of the bands that were around in London at the time. By 93, it was all turning into something interesting. I don't think they'd come up with that horrible word Britpop yet, but there was a new movement of bands. It was before it really broke and got spoiled by getting too commercialized. It still was just a bunch of people in secondhand clothes getting wasted in Camden.
Brett Anderson. My father was a taxi-driving Franz Liszt obsessive and had passed his passion for music down to me. From a young age, I thought being in a band was pretty much the best thing that anyone could do with their life. It seems almost anachronistic now that music has been so cruelly marginalised by social media, but throughout my youth, it seemed that music, to misquote Bill Shankly, wasn't just a matter of life and death, it was more important than that. I had stumbled through the usual parade of embarrassing teenage bands, endless afternoons sat on single beds strumming out-of-tune guitars. But arriving in London as a student in the 80s and meeting Matt and Justine, ideas had started to percolate and things had started to get a little more serious. One day, in 1989, I remember watching some awful poodle rock outfit running dutifully through their sequence of tired posturing on Top of the Pops and thinking, shit. I can do better than that. The following day, I put an advert for a guitar player in the NME. And a few weeks later, a quiet, intense young man called Bernard Butler turned up on my doorstep. George Chesterton, journalist. Suede saved British pop music. In 1992, there was no glamour, style, or sex in the charts, which were squatted in by Euro House, the unconscionably bland, and bands who didn't care how they looked or even sounded. Then Suede came along in their crimpline shirts and leather jackets and said, "Come to the cabaret." They were rushed onto the covers of magazines before they even had an album deal, and their first three singles created a hysteria that consumed teenage girls, style-conscious boys, indie kids, and any old outsider searching for a home. Less than a year later, their first album, Suede, became the fastest-selling debut for a decade. It was as if someone had applied a cultural defibrillator. In Brett Anderson, they had a nose-in-the-air frontman who sang about satellite towns and rough trade, while protean guitarist Bernard Butler switched from crunching rock chords to lyrical ballads at will. They were the most interesting and lithe partnership since Morrissey and Marr. Suede were pretty. They were power pop and art rock, seedy, funny, and a tad pretentious. Exactly what a great band is supposed to be. And they were unashamedly, excitingly un-American. An antidote to grunge and an androgynous swish against the fading machismo of Manchester. All over Britain, kids with floppy fringes and no rhythm were swaying in bedrooms and student unions because their lives had been lit up by some poseurs from Haywards Heath. Brett Anderson. In the very early 90s, I was living on benefits in a scruffy rented flat in Notting Hill, in a kind of desultory post-degree fug. Much of my time was spent shuffling up to the Dole office on Lisson Grove and applying for jobs for which it seemed I was either always over or underqualified. This was more than a decade before that part of town became synonymous with wealth and status, when most of the shops along Westbourne Grove, which are now boutiques, were junk shops like Sue Ryder or Cancer Research.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.